I want to just mention to you that each year, and I've been here 22 years, students inspire me on a daily basis. One of the real joys of teaching and working in a community college is that I continue to learn. No 2 days are the same. And it is in that spirit that I introduce to you our graduate, Sarah Reid, and I'm delighted to do so. She sat in my office 3 years ago, certainly a little unsure of herself, uncertain about what courses she was going to take. She'd come back to the community college with a GED. She was a single mom, like many of you sitting in this room, that you've come back to explore what you can learn at the community college. She took only 2 courses at a time, like many of you do. And when she took Introduction to Women's Studies, she realized that some of her classmates believed the myths and stereotypes about welfare moms. And she wanted to broaden her classmates' view. She said, "I wanted others to see what a welfare mom looked like. Me, a committed student and a caring mom." She also said that her women's studies courses here at GCC have permitted her to make personal and academic connections. And it's a belief that I think the entire Women's Studies Steering Committee, but many of the faculty and staff here at GCC have, to bridge the gap between what's going on in your personal lives and what's happening here at school. She was one of 7 interns at Ms. Magazine this summer, the only community college intern, for which we are very proud. And she's going to speak to you today about her experiences at Ms. Magazine and her experiences at GCC in Women's Studies and the F word, feminism. So I will let Sarah take over.
Thank you so much for coming to see me today. I want to first mention that I took speech here with Saul Greenblatt. And the first day of that class, he said, "Is anyone totally petrified of public speaking?" And I was the only one who raised my hand. His office is in South 208, so if I bomb, you can complain to him. I wanted to do an informal survey first. I was wondering who's read Ms.
Who's what?
Who's read Ms. magazine?
Anyone just looked at it? Same people? Okay. And who's in a women's studies class right now? Okay. I want to get us all on the same page. Ms. is not a fashion magazine, which I've heard a lot, actually. It's a feminist magazine. It's 27 years old, and it's ad-free. It runs totally without advertising. So it was a very hot summer. I don't know if all of you are here, but it was 100 degrees for a month of July, and it was the hottest summer ever recorded in New York City since they started recording these things. And so while I tell you the story of my summer, please remember that I was melting. Before I get to the events that led me here today, before I get to the events that led me to this summer, I felt a responsibility to talk about the word feminism and women's studies and why they're relevant today and as we head into the next century. I think it's really simple that as long as there has to be women's studies to round out the gaps in our education, women in lit is necessary, for example, because women writers are not included in basic lit courses, and so on. As long as it's necessary to specifically inform students about the lives of women because they are not included in the tellings of the lives of humans, feminism will be too. Feminism will be necessary as long as there is inequality for the sexes, and there is so much disparity in the way that we as gendered beings live our lives today that I can't help but feel despair when Time magazine suggests that feminism is dead. I don't think that anyone would suggest that the fight against racism should be abandoned, nor do I think anyone would suggest that class disparity is no longer an issue in this country. And yet, when it comes to women's movements, the media has always been quick to declare it over. The other thing I wanted to say about feminism, and this was really brought home for me in the class at GCC, where I heard many misconceptions of the word, feminism is not about male bashing or man hating. As Phyllis Naiman said on her first day of Intro to Women's Studies, this class is not about male bashing, We live in the world together. Heck, I even married a man. What feminism does is it looks at the ways in which society deals with its men and women. It looks at gender specifically, gender roles, and says, these are not right. They're not fair or healthy. We need to study them, and then we're going to change them. Feminism has not and has never been about reversing sexism or dominating men. It would only have things be better for humans as they inhabit their bodies as engendered beings. While I was an intern at Ms. Magazine this summer, Woodstock 99 happened. For those of you who don't know, Woodstock 99 was to be a rehashing of the 69 concert that was all about free love, drugs. I wasn't there, but... but sadly and quickly, this latest one turned into a chaotic rape and pillage fest that resulted in huge fires, many injuries, and according to which newspaper you read, anywhere between 1 and 8 women raped while the concerts were going on by male drunk concert goers. The news of this concert gone wrong got to Ms. very quickly, and we were sent an especially graphic story of one person's eyewitness account of the mess left behind. And I can't read it to you because it's really nauseating. I've put it on the table if you want to read it. And we don't know if we're going to print it. That has yet to be decided. But it certainly we didn't read about in the New York Times. This, when we got this email, it reminded me of why I was at Ms. et al. It reminded me of what I'm doing with my life. A couple of weeks before I got to Ms., a woman was beaten to death in Central Park, 20 blocks up from where I was staying. Every day, as I got onto the subway to head down to Wall Street, I wondered if I would get into the car that had the extensive End Domestic Violence campaign plastered on its ceilings, lining it with images of beaten women's faces. At Ms., we would get calls from women seeking help, seeking escape or child custody advice, seeking justice or revenge for sexual harassment, seeking help that we as a national magazine could not give. We were part referral service, or at least tried to be. I came about this ad on the day I started writing this speech in The Nation. It says, should America be measured by 3 women CEOs in the Fortune 500 or by 13 million women in poverty? Which is the question that I think feminism is constantly trying to address. The exceptions to the rule, the 3 women who have broken the glass ceiling, are always used against feminists to disprove their arguments for equality. But we have to be vigilant in remembering that exceptions never tell a whole story. As long as there are women in danger, women starving themselves or being starved in poverty, women underpaid, the world in our society is not working. It's not working for anyone to live in a sexist society. When we assume that women alone take care of babies and supply them with changing tables in their public restrooms, we are not only feeding into a stereotype and making sweeping assumptions about women as caretakers, we are depriving men of the joys of child rearing and making it much harder for them to get in on the act that is so incredibly important to both sexes, child rearing. When we assume that women are more emotional than intellectual, we are not only robbing them of career opportunity and reducing them to tear-stained stereotypes, we are depriving men of the basic human outlets that displays of emotion supply and are creating an expectancy for men that can't possibly be fulfilled. It's as if we took a whole person full of human potential, emotion, intellect, and split it down the middle into 2 parts, assigning each part a gender, and then asked them to function without their other natural half. And along with this split, we've made being one half, the male half, much more valuable in this country and sadly throughout the world. I came to women's studies and ultimately Ms. because I saw a t-shirt when I was 9, and that's true. It said, feminism is the radical notion that women are people too. I also saw a bumper sticker when I was 9 or 10, somewhere in there, that read, I only know that I get called a feminist when I try to differentiate myself from a doormat. I was 9, I was 10, I was young. This doormat thing struck me really hard. This people thing really hurt. I was a person, wasn't I? Who thought that I wasn't? I was being fitted, unbeknownst to me, with what we in women's studies call the gender lenses. Kate uses that term quite often. it's like this. Some people try on the race lenses. And what clearly race in this country is very hard to talk about, very hard to negotiate, and very hard to experience if you're in the minority. Some people try on the class lenses, and when we know that through them as well, the world is not working, there are millions of people in poverty and a couple really rich white guys. And some people put on the sexual orientation lenses and say, there's really two words this word for that, Matthew Shepard. And being gay in this country doesn't work either. In fact, it's downright dangerous. But I tried on the gender lenses, and they stuck. I'm no genius at studying gender, but it's my passion, and I have been unable and unwilling to take these lenses off in my 15 years of calling myself a feminist. I would no sooner take them off than I would my own glasses, and I'm blind without them, so that would be really stupid. I started out on my academic journey towards raging feminism when I started attending classes here in the fall of 1996. That was the same year that the Welfare Reform Bill went into act. I took English 101 in a history class. At the time, I was a single mom on welfare with no direction. I just wanted to get out of the house, and I always thought that pursuing my education would be a good thing to do. I was enrolled as a liberal arts major, as so many of us are, and enjoyed my small amount of time up here. In my second semester, I took Intro to Women's Studies with Phyllis Naiman and Speech 101 with Salt. I almost instantly got a new advisor, Anne Wiley, and changed my major to Women's Studies. I can't really recall the moment when I knew that Women's Studies was right for me. As I said, it was just the way I'd already chosen to look at the world. I suppose the fact that there was an actual department to support me was irresistible, and that's why I made the switch. From there, and I was hooked, and over the course of 3 years, I took every Women's Studies class offered but one. I got to know most of the department pretty well, and now count them as my friends. One semester, I had 4 women in classes, which was really overwhelming. I researched breastfeeding and the infant formula industry extensively. I talked about my experiences on welfare, as Anne mentioned. I actually taught a class on gender representation to a group of kids. Some of them are here today. Thank you for coming. And as Saul knows, I gave an impassioned speech on public breastfeeding, a thing that one of my classmates likened to spitting in public, complete with sound effects. I was undaunted. Nothing could stop me. I processed and processed gender. Every movie, show, conversation, letter, magazine, every interaction I had was held up for scrutiny through my unforgiving gender lenses. And then it was my last semester and I needed a plan. Honestly, I thought that going on to more school would kill me. So I put up applying to anyone. In February of this year, I went to a reading of a book called Adios Barbie in a bookstore in Amherst. And I actually went more because I had a crush on the bookstore owner than because I wanted to hear about the book.
That's another story.
That didn't pan out, he moved to Guatemala. Little did I know that the editor of this book, Ophira Adut, had recently been hired by Ms. Magazine as an associate editor. And I had read Ms. for quite a long time and was excited to be in the presence of someone who had input there. She had brought along another editor, Jeanne Panache, who's in charge of the internship program, and they asked the audience for suggestions for the magazine. It had just been relaunched under a new ownership, and they were still trying to make it better and more accessible. Jeanne also said that if anyone was interested in internships, they should put down their name and addresses on a piece of paper, and she would take them back using those guidelines. I did this, not because I wanted an internship, but because I thought it would be amazing to have this editor from Ms. Magazine go back to New York and look at her notes and see my name. That was the extent of my intentions. Well, she sent the guidelines via email, which I have here if you would like to look at them, and I knew I had to apply. My heart started racing and I ran home to tell my mother that I wanted to go work in New York for the summer. Meanwhile, I have a small child, a new house, and a dog. She was nice and nodded her head without laughing at me, and soon I began the application process. For 3 weeks, I worked on my resume and cover letter. I made up a fancy blue vinyl envelope, something I suggest to everyone, make your envelope really irresistible. I decorated with old Ms. covers and sent it off. I was supposed to have heard by April 1st, but by the time it came around, I was preparing to work in retail this summer. I was sure that I wasn't going to get it. G-Man had said it was very competitive. She got over 100 applications, that I should try again if I didn't get it. April 1st came and went. April 4th came and went, and I was looking for mom dads. April 6th, Gina called, talked to me for about 10 minutes, and uttered the words that are imprinted on my brain to this day. Well, we already decided that we wanted to offer you the internship, so if you think... I died. I fell on the floor. I really did. I had a week to decide if I could actually take the internship. I gave my dog away. I rented my house for the summer. I got a friend's mother to agree to put me up in her Central Park West townhouse for free and collaborated an elaborate schedule for my son, one in which he would be with his father for 2 days, my mother for 2 days, and then with me for three. I would go down Monday mornings on a bus, a 5-hour ride, and come back Thursday night so that I could be with him Friday mornings. I borrowed money, I was given gifts, and vowed to not do any shopping at all in New York. The internship paid $250 per month, and my bus fare alone was $247. I didn't care, and I had to do it my first day. I got there 2 hours early after a mishap on the subway. I ended up in the wrong place, but found my way. I sat in a really expensive cafe, drinking really bad coffee for 2 hours, really nervous. I finally went to Exchange Place, which is right below Wall Street. I went up to the 22nd floor, opened the door, a big, beautiful door with big brass knobs and no windows, so you have no idea what you're coming into. And the interns were already there. There were five other interns joining me that day. They were all younger than me. We were taken down the long hall that is Ms. Ms. is just one long hall with little offices off of it. And we were put into the conference room to wait for the weekly editorial meeting. Gloria Steinem walked in. And I died again. She was small, very friendly, had huge sunglasses on, and smelled really nice. The meeting began, and none of the interns had any idea what anything was. The 10 editors discussed articles and authors we had never heard of and kept saying TK over and over again. Like, well, that piece is coming in TK. Or, well, the author is still TK. And it being my first day, I didn't ask. That same day, we were handed a basket of unsolicited manuscripts and told to reject all the bad stuff. I rejected MIT professors, Harvard professors, Naomi Wolf's friend. It was incredible to see what came into the magazine, as well as to develop an eye for what would be interesting to put into it. I didn't feel useful for a couple of weeks, only because I hadn't learned the ropes yet. And then I got a writing assignment. I would have to interview and write a 200-word blurb on a woman in Chicago who gets up on tables and shows her cervix to the audience. She does this for money and for the cause. She's not some freak. And I talked to her extensively and wrote extensively and ended up with 200 words. And that was really my first professional writing assignment. I don't know if it will ever get published. It was eye-opening, certainly. And through that experience, I realized what the name Ms. can and can't get you. You say the name Ms. and most people my age say what, they have no idea what it is. They think it's a fashion magazine. But you say to women in their 30s, 40s, and up, and you've got a captive audience. In fact, almost everyone I wanted to interview or needed help from dropped everything to help the intern from Ms. The only time the name was a hindrance was when we wanted a publicity headshot of the rapper Eminem, who's notorious for his violently misogynistic lyrics. And guess what? His publicist said, I didn't think that would be such a good idea. And I had to agree because we didn't have many nice things to say about him, so we ended up using the cover of Rolling Stone. That's an issue that I brought. I quickly became the cartoon editor. The art director said she couldn't stand picking them out, and if I avoided the cat jokes, I could have the job. I located my favorite cartoonist, Miriam Henley, who used to run in The Advocate. I got her to send a bunch of stuff up to me, which we published in the next issue. I was sent to the private media screening of Ken Burns's Not For Ourselves Alone that you just spoke of. That was an incredible experience. I was in jeans, and the editor said, you want to go? And so I went, and it was unbelievable. I met him, I got his autograph, I brought that here. I met Elizabeth Vargas from ABC News. I met three of Stanton's descendants, and I met a 100-year-old woman who remembered voting for the first time, which really put into perspective what I'm doing today. I helped the homicide unit in Hoboken, New Jersey, investigate a murder they were doing. They thought it was an honor killing, which is practiced mostly in the Middle East when a young woman either has an extramarital affair or premarital sex. Her family will actually kill her. It's an honor to keep the honor of the family. And they had a 15-year-old murder in New Jersey that they thought might be an honor killing, and they wanted all of our research, so that was confiscated. I helped an exile author living in Sweden somewhere, avoiding arrest in India for telling the truth, to get published by giving the Free Thought Press a safe way to get in touch with her, and she will be coming out with a book now, which is really exciting. I wrote about a ritual my community did for a group of our girls turning 13 and had it published on page 66 of the current issue. I went to the Bronx Zoo on a very hot day with the whole magazine. We discussed JFK Jr. and how hot he was, and contemplated gorilla behavior for several days after. I helped pick covers, colors, taglines, you name it, I had my hands in it. This is a very small magazine compared to most. It's 100 pages of editorial pages. There's no advertising. It's put out by 10 editors, 2 art directors. It's very, very small. So in every aspect, I was involved. They were so excited to have us there that they threw us 3 parties during the course of the summer and were always apologetic. There was an editor who would literally come up, hunched over, and she'd say, "Can you copy this for me? I'm really sorry." And we would always laugh at her, because that was what we were there for. We were told that we would have to do all of the grunt office work. The process of creating the magazine was fascinating to me, but especially because I consider it to be the pinnacle of feminist journalism. I was surprised, not because I don't have faith in this school, but because I just didn't realize how much I had learned here. To find that as soon as I figured out what TK means, I know you're all wondering, it means to come. If we don't know when the date is or what the author is, we say, "It's coming, TK." It doesn't make sense, but. So once I figured that out, I actually knew most of the books and the authors that were being thrown around. I had actually read that study in one of my classes or had seen an article that some of them hadn't. I felt incredibly informed, and I really think that that was due to my classes here. Most importantly, I had been prepared by my teachers here for the level of critical thinking that I needed to apply to editing articles and discussing upcoming issues. All in all, it was a blurry, exhilarating, and crazy summer. I can't believe that I'm published in my favorite magazine. I can't believe that I worked with a personal hero who symbolizes the modern women's movement. And I really can't believe that I'm here talking to you today. But what I appreciate most about the experience is the perspective I now have on feminism and the direction that I think it needs to go. A perfect real meeting once that sums up what the women's movement has come to. We were talking about doing a photo shoot to parody Glamour magazine's do and don't pages. Does anybody read Glamour? You can admit it? Really? Okay. Really? I don't know. Okay, so I do. The back page. They send a photographer out to take pictures of women in New York City, and they decide whether their outfits are good. And if they're good, your face is totally clear, and it says, "Do wear your hair like this when wearing boots like this." And if it's a don't, they black out your eyes, and they say, "Don't ever match this fabric with that handbag." So they do this whole back page collage of them. So we were thinking about doing a parody on that, where we would have a woman with her eyes blacked out accepting 70 cents from a man, and we would write underneath it, "Don't accept 70 cents to the dollar," because that's what women earn today. But we were trying to come up with more ideas like that, and the editor-in-chief, Marcia Ann Gillespie, suggested, "Do wear comfortable shoes." And that made sense to me. I had noticed on the subways everywhere, women crammed into these high heels. We all know what they do to us. I don't know why anybody wears them. And I instantly agreed. But then Jen, the art director, who's much younger and much more hip, said, "Well, why not do wear slut shoes?" And all of a sudden, everyone stopped. And it went unsaid, but it hung there for everyone to feel. That is what feminism has gotten us, the right to do both on our own terms, which I think in some way is actually a bad thing, which sounds funny. I mean, I guess it's great that we feel as if we can make empowered choices for ourselves. We can wear comfortable shoes or we could wear slut shoes. But I have to wonder what the factors would be behind someone wanting to wear really uncomfortable shoes. and all of my studying here and elsewhere leads me to believe that we are not as empowered as we think we are. The whole girl power movement, I believe, has actually stunted the true work of empowerment. Because self-love and health and empowerment cannot be bought on a t-shirt at JCPenney. And no matter what Barbie's new ad campaign is, buying into Barbie has never and will probably never be empowering. Anyway, that moment pointed out the biggest thing for me concerning feminism, which is that my generation, don't have a big, large, easy to hold, tangible cause to rally around. We don't have abortion. We don't have the vote or legislation to bring us out into the forefront anymore, to unite us in a common push for equality. And I think that that's sad, although I'm grateful to have the vote and to have choice and to be protected and entitled by law. But I can't help but wish that there was one big thing that I could unite and fight for with my sisters. I think that the job feminism has is made much harder by not having a specific movement to latch onto. And I sense that it's wilting in some ways, which is not to suggest that it's dead, but I do think that we need to reevaluate, reprioritize, and re-energize, and we certainly need to continue to educate girls growing up today about the struggles we've had just to get to where we are today, which I would argue is nowhere near where we have to get to be truly equal and healthy in today's society. If you look at the masthead, and I've brought old Mrs. and new Mrs. If you look at the masthead, which is where they list all the editors, in the first Ms., you see a line that says editors, and you see Gloria Steinem and Mary Tome and Letty Palgren, and that's it. It just says editors. If you look at it now, it says editor-in-chief, executive editor, senior editor, associate editor, and then interns at the bottom in really little letters. And I think that this practice is not in the spirit of feminism, that for so long we have fought against hierarchy and patriarchy and all of the notions that we've been raised with about value and importance as it pertains to gender, that to value workers on the magazine in such an uneven way is missing the point, is missing the reason why Ms. exists at all. A lot of the editors are on their way out. Ophira Adut, who I met in February, is already gone after only 7 months of being there. Most of the interns were journalism majors, not women's studies major, and not particularly passionate about feminism. These little signs are symbols of the disconnect I'm feeling around what was once an overwhelming passion for feminism. Honestly, I worry about the future of feminism and of women's studies, which is why I think the future of feminism has to include more dialogue with men and the eventual shift to gender studies. We are not there yet, and won't be until Austin and Wolf are taught right along Dickens and Joyce, until the lives and accomplishments of women are taught equally at every level of education. But I intend to see the day when men can be like women, and women can be like men, when we will learn of work life and home life, and value them equally, when we will allow the two halves within each of us. That is my rallying cause. That is what excites me about feminism and the study of gender. I feel that the next movement is one of inclusion, conversation, and compassionate understanding between the two sexes. I would love to even see a magazine someday that specifically addressed gender issues that both men and women could read, and I don't mean the kind of magazine that would tell you how to have multiple orgasms or lose 30 pounds. There is a lot of work to be done to make the world a safer and more hospitable place for women and for men in these classrooms, at Ms., and in all of our own lives. But I can honestly say that I trust these professors, and I trust the editors at Ms., and I trust people everywhere to become educated and to become or stay active, to keep the fight going as long as it needs to go. And I would say to you, find your passion, as I have, whatever it may be. It could be any of the things I talked about earlier. It could be jewelry making. It could be engineering. It could be saving the planet. But if you can find something that you believe in so much that it keeps you up at night, then you will always be genuine. And you get internships. And you get jobs. And you get heard when you can say something and mean it.